We have just released a new beta of Directory Opus, and we thought that we'd make this video to show off some of the new features. This video is a bit of an experiment, and we don't plan to make videos like this for every minor Opus update, but it seemed like there are enough changes in this one to give the idea a try. Like most updates, there are lots of small changes that you can read about in the release notes, and I'm not going to bore you by reading through the whole list, I just want to show you some of the highlights. Let's start with some cosmetic features. In a window like this, the active side is the source, and the other side is the destination. If I select some files on the left and then click Move, they'll move to the right. If I then select some files on the right-hand side, it becomes the source, and when I click Move, those files get moved over to the left-hand side. You can drag files between the sides, of course, but that isn't always convenient if you're dealing with a large number. We've always had various visual cues to help you see which side is active. Some people wanted more than this though, so we've added a new option to change the background colour of the destination file display, and that makes things really obvious. I'm using the dropper here just to grab the colour straight off the background of that sign. And there you go. Folder tabs can now be drawn with and without visual styles, whether or not you also define custom colours for them. In the past, the colours and styles have been tied together in various ways, but someone was always left unhappy, so now we've made the two things independent. By default, the tabs use visual styles and standard colours, but you can change either or both of those if you want. That should cover all the different possibilities, and hopefully everybody's happy now. Enough about cosmetics, let's look at something functional. When you're in a folder that has some hidden files, Opus shows a hidden count at the bottom of the window on the status bar. I'm using my own status bar configuration here, so this isn't exactly what you'll see, but the default configuration shows similar information, and the differences aren't very important. When there are hidden items, they're usually things that you don't want to see, and that's why they're hidden. But since they are hidden, you can't always be sure that they are what you think they are, and sometimes you need to check. In the past, finding out what was hidden was quite tedious. You had to go into here, change your settings, maybe also change some filters, just to find out what was there. Once you'd done all that, you then had to do it all again, just to get back to normal. In the new version, instead of doing all of that, just move your mouse and hover over the hidden count on the status bar, and a tooltip will appear telling you what's hidden. Much easier. This also works with items that are hidden via the filter bar. You may have noticed, near the middle of my toolbars, the desktop shortcut and drive buttons. Those let me quickly access commonly used locations and starting points with a single click. They're not part of the default configuration, but they also aren't anything new. There are lots of other ways to quickly navigate to folders, including this menu at the root of the breadcrumbs bar, custom hotkeys, favourites, aliases, and so on. Different methods suit different people. In this new version, we've added yet another method that some people have asked for, and I'll go into customise mode now and set that up. I could do this to an existing toolbar, but I'm just going to create a new one to keep things simple. So if I click on the new toolbar button here, and then give it a name, I'll just call it Drive Lists. It doesn't really matter what you call it. And that'll create a little toolbar that appears at the bottom of the main window. Now I'll go onto the Commands tab, and drag out the new item. So to find the new item, I'll just type in Drive into the filter here, and that quickly filters out all the other things. Drive buttons at the top there is the old thing, and below that Drive List is the new thing. And that's the one we want. So I'm going to grab Drive List and just drag that onto my new toolbar. Initially it's just a rectangular placeholder, and when I exit customise mode, well, it still looks like a rectangular thing, but now it actually is usable, and you can see that it lets me quickly change drives via a drop-down list that uses less space than the drive buttons did. By default, this remembers where you are on each of the drives, so if I go into a folder below C, and then change to the D drive, and go into a folder below D, when I change back and forth, it remembers where I was on each drive. You can further customise the drive list with similar arguments to those that are accepted by the existing Drive Buttons command. For example, there's a lot of empty drives in this list, and you might want to exclude those, and you can do that by going back into Customise mode, right-click it, edit it, and in this args field add Hide Empty. So if I OK that, and then OK the Customise dialog as well to save the change, when I open up that drives list, you can see all the empty drives are gone now, so it's a lot easier to use. If you normally use dual display windows, then you might want to have two drop-downs, one for each side. So back into customize mode we go, and I'll just right-click this, copy that drives list, and paste another one right next to it, so they're both the same. And I'm also going to insert a spacer, which I'll put between the two of them. And I'm going to make that full width. That means that it will use up all the spare space on the toolbar. And that will mean that we've got one on the left and one on the right, because that space has taken up the gap in between. Now it looks like this one on the right's doing the correct thing. It's actually not yet. If I change the one on the left, you'll see it's changing the right display at the moment. And these two aren't actually tied to either side. They're both currently changing the source file display, i.e. the one with the blue bar at the top. So to change that, we've got to go back into customize mode. And like we did just a minute ago, I'm going to right-click and edit and add a new argument. And in the left one, it's left. And as you can guess, in the right one, the argument is right. So now the two lists are tied to their respective sides, and it doesn't matter which side is the source, they'll always change the correct one. There's a bunch of other arguments you can give to modify the behaviour of the drive lists, and that's all in the manual. So just type in drive list into the search field, or find the drive list configuration page, and scroll down to the bottom of there, and you can see all the different options you can add. The way drive lists remember the current directory for different drives can now also be applied to other places via the go command's new cur-dir argument, and that's also in the manual. For a long time now, Opus has supported the ability to export a portable copy to a USB device. If you did this from a 64-bit machine, you've always had to choose between exporting a 32-bit or a 64-bit copy. Having to choose isn't ideal because you can't always predict what you'll end up using, and while the 32-bit version works with anything, there are drawbacks to using a 32-bit file manager with 64-bit Windows. The new version of Opus gives you the option of exporting both versions to the same USB stick. If you need to save space, then you can still choose one version or the other, but most people will want to export both. When it comes time to use the exported copy, you don't have to work out what kind of machine you're on. Opus takes care of that for you, and the little exe that's written to the root of the drive will automatically choose the correct version each time you run it. With the more recent versions of Firefox, MuTorrent, and a couple of other tools, when you ask them to open a folder, an Opus window would open as you'd expect, but then, usually a few seconds later, maybe another Opus window would open, or sometimes an Explorer window or an error message instead. As we promised, this new version of Opus fixes all those problems, so I can show you that using the Firefox Downloads window. If I right-click one of my downloads and open Containing Folder, that'll open an Opus window, and you won't see any other Opus windows open by mistake now. Do the same with another file, and that opens the same window, or reuses it rather. And Opus is also selecting the file that Firefox asks it to, which is another new feature. Similarly, if I switch to MuTorrent, you can see that when I right-click a torrent and do Open Containing Folder, an Opus window opens, and only one. If I do the same to another torrent, the window for that folder also opens, and Opus is also selecting the thing that MuTorrent asks it to. So that's all good. One of the viewer pane fixes is worth mentioning quickly. If you go to your fonts folder, and I'll just close the tree and turn on the viewer. Now if you select the fonts, the viewer correctly tracks which file you selected. At some point that got broken, and we've now fixed that. Let's go back to talking about new features. We've added some new columns to both the file display and the find tool. And one of those is a disk number column for audio files. So I'll go into the folder options dialog here. I'll drag out the new disk number column, stick it next to track number. So that should be pretty self-explanatory. Obviously, this will depend on your files being tagged correctly. One thing that might not be obvious is that I can group by that column, so now the files are grouped by disk. And you can group by any column just by holding down Alt and clicking on it. The other new columns are for image files that contain DPI information, and the new columns are called physical height, physical width, and between the two, physical size. The physical size column is a combination of both the other two. As you can see, if you divide the pixel dimensions by the DPI, you get the physical size. By default, Opus allows the image files themselves to specify which units to use, and all my test files seem to use inches, so that's what you see here. However, you can override the physical size units via a new advanced preferences option called Image Res Units. Staying with the advanced topics, let's look at some new things that you can do with Opus commands. First, let me set up a button which just prints the selected file names to a DOS window. None of this is new, but we'll build on this button in a moment. I'm giving the button an icon and a label, but obviously these are just minor details. I'll set the command type to MS-DOS batch function, and that makes it output to a DOS window. I'm using the standard DOS echo command, which will just repeat whatever arguments I give it, and I'm passing it the selected file names, one per line. The pause command makes the DOS window stay open when the command is run. So when I select these files and click my new button, you can see it's output each of those files, one per line. There was only one echo command in the original button, but because the file path code only outputs one file at a time, Opus has repeated that line. You can also see that it's put quotes around the file names, and that's because they contain spaces. I'm going to edit the button now, and first I'm just going to put the label on the right so it stops changing the toolbar height. And I'm also going to add no deselect, which means that I don't have to keep reselecting the files every time I run the button. That doesn't change what the command does, it just makes my life easier here. Now suppose you want to use the full path to our files as a subdirectory below some other location. For example, you might want to create a backup somewhere that preserves the original file path. Obviously my test command here isn't even trying to copy anything, it's just printing out the names of things, but hopefully you can imagine how the same techniques could be used in a real command. My command will now print the file path twice, and the second time we'll have dbackups added to the start of that path. When I run that command on the files again, there are two problems, and the first of those is that there's now a quote in the middle of the second path, and that's because the automatic quoting didn't account for the fact that we're adding on something at the start. So let's fix that first, that's really simple. You can add in another modifier, no file name quoting, and that turns off the automatic quoting, in which case you have to put the quotes in yourself. So Opus tries to be intelligent, but where that fails, you can switch it into manual mode. So run that again, and the quotes are now in the right place. And that leaves us with the second problem, which is this colon in the middle of the path. You can't have C colon in the middle of a path and below another directory, because it's a drive letter. So fixing that brings us to the first of our new things. We've added two new ways to deal with this kind of problem, and the first is this no root modifier. So I've added no root on the end, and when I run the command again, you can see that the C colon has been removed completely. You'd probably use this mostly if you were copying from one drive to another, from the root of one drive to another, and you wanted to exactly recreate what was there. The other thing we've added is subdir. So this is quite similar, but instead of removing the C colon, it will convert it. So that's actually turned the colon into a semicolon. I don't know if you can see that in the video. Hopefully the high-res version will show that up at least. But that allows you to use that path almost the same as it was, but converted to work. I'm going to show you a completely different command now, and to do that I'm going to reuse this test button, but completely clear out everything that was there. So I've set it to a standard function and deleted the old command. So I'm going to use the file type command and the new argument, and this is sort of like the standard new menu that you get when you right-click an Explorer or an Opus, but it lets you do the same thing with a command. With those arguments, the command will create a new text file and ask for the file name. Now my aim is to run Notepad on this text file after it's been created, and to do that I use this new file variable, which is automatically set to the file name that you choose. So when I run this button, it should create a new text file, ask me what name I want to give it, and then open that file in Notepad, all with one click. So let's click on that and see what happens. You can see it's created a new text file. I type in the name, and as soon as I press return, it's opened up in Notepad. So I can save that file out, and I can look at it. You can see in the text file thumbnail there, what I typed into Notepad is already in the file. And I'll just pop on the viewer so you can see there as well. In this fairly simple example, you're only really saving one or two keystrokes, but hopefully you can imagine how the same techniques could be used with complex multi-step commands to save a lot of time and effort. Well, that's everything I wanted to show you for this new version. Hope you enjoy using it. See you later.